So what I wanted to do is to take us through a little bit of the background information so that we can all be on the same page of the information that we gathered about what is happening across the country. So one of the first questions that people say is, well, you know, we have some very good private universities in this country. The private universities can take up the slack and just do all this work. Well, it turns out that only 22 states host a very high research activity or high research activity private universities. 28 states do not have a very high research activity private university. And so clearly this is not an area that we can simply privatize, nor do we think that would be good for the country. So when we looked at our cohort of institutions that we thought should compromise our or comprise our work with the Lincoln Project, we took public, very high, or high research activity, and Lincoln's legacy is pretty dramatic here, is that every single state has at least one of these institutions, really creating what we believe is the intellectual infrastructure of the country. So how do these institutions serve us and serve the nation? So we've only considered here the very high research activity and high research activity institutions, either public or private. At the undergraduate level, the difference in the numbers of students that are served is pretty dramatic. And in fact, these are 2010 numbers. And so if we were to look at 2016, they're dramatically higher because we've seen much more uptake of students at the undergraduate level of these institutions. So at publics, it's 2.7 million. At privates, it's 474,000. The graduate numbers really show you sort of the same trend. 615,000. Again, this has grown dramatically in the last 4 or 5 years. 615,000 at the publics and 288 at the private. So the impact is pretty large. The other thing that surprised us a little bit, perhaps it shouldn't have, is what has happened in terms of student enrollment between 1987 and 2012. And those top three lines, the only important thing about those top three lines is that those are the public PRUs, the public research universities. The bottom line, which has not grown very much at all, are the private research universities or the public doctorals. The public doctoral institutions tend to be those universities that don't do a lot of research activity, but they do have some doctoral programs, and they've not grown very much at all. So we've seen this dramatic growth at these PRUs, and so with fewer resources, these institutions are educating ever more students. The other piece of data that really did surprise us a lot is the expenditures per FTE student between 1987 and 2012. And so that red line at the top is elite private universities that have big endowments. So they are spending more per student. All the bottom ones are all others, public research universities, doctoral institutions. Really, I think what this represents is a very efficient delivery of education to this big sector across. Now, it's great that the private institutions that have big endowments can spend more per student, but in fact, we would contend that these wonderful public research universities are delivering a high-quality education at a very, very efficient cost. So let's look at the access measures. This is another where we really begin to see the importance of this cohort of universities in our country. So what we try to do is to group the income spectrum here, the strata, so that we could see what's happening. In the low income, middle income, all of those grouped together, the private institutions, the students at those institutions are 29% of their students. At publics, it's almost 45%. The middle and the high income, they're pretty much the same, 34% for the private, 36% for public. But again, you see the disparity for high income, almost 37% at private institutions and only 19% at public. And when you think about the scale difference, that is the numbers of students that are being educated, these percentages represent huge numbers of students in the public research universities that are providing access for higher education and professional and doctoral education. The same holds true for underrepresented minority students per institution at the undergraduate level. You have about 3.5 times more the mean numbers at the publics than at the privates. At the graduate level, this does even out so that the private institutions are doing a good job at providing opportunity for underrepresented minority institutions. One of the other pieces of information that really did astound us, and this has just recently become available, and I want to explain this map to you. So what this represents is a new way of looking at expenditures, federal research dollar expenditures for the conduct of research. And this is going on, this analysis is going on at the Institute for Research on Innovation in Science at the University of Michigan. The director of that institute is Jason Owen Smith, and he has many collaborators around the country. And so what this map represents is eight Midwest universities, only eight, where they spent the federal dollars that came in for research. This represents $1.7 billion in research expenditures. So these are money, funds that would have come into eight universities from NSF, NIH, NOAA, NASA, the funding agencies. Where did the dollars actually get spent? So I was at the invitation of Governor Bredesen. We were in Nashville last week talking to a group of legislators. And I said, I want to point out to you that actually in Tennessee, there's some expenditure of research dollars for goods and services that for research being conducted at the University of Michigan. And they were astounded at this fact. So what we're trying to show here, and we hope that as more people join the IRIS project, we can track dollars to show that this is a big economic impact across the country. And this is just eight universities. This is not the 143 that that comprise our PRU project. So what we want to try to really reveal for people is how this is such a big, important part of the infrastructure of the country. So one of the recommendations that you'll see in our report is that public universities have to become much more aggressive in terms of philanthropy as part of their revenue streams. And what we discovered in our meetings around the country is that almost all public universities are in campaigns or planning campaigns or trying to beef up their development activities. But we have a long way to go, because what this simply represents is those two top lines are the private institutions and the revenue from their endowments that they can spend per student, and on the bottom is everybody else. And this, the publics, and this particular sort of pink line shows the AAU public institutions that have been in the fundraising business for a longer time than some of the other public institutions. But in order for us to bridge this gap, it's going to take a long time and a lot of activity. But at least it's something that we recommend that institutions invest in, because we do think that it can help as part of the picture of the new financial reality. The other thing that we hear a lot about, and we wanted to document again in this study, is the trade-off between state funding and tuition revenue. And this is, we see this over and over again. That amber line shows what's happened to state funding for public universities, the AAU public. Same is true of the non-AAU public. Very high research activity, and tuitions have had to rise because there's no other source of funding. No realistic source of funding for these institutions. And then this bar chart simply shows you the revenue sources and how they've changed between 2001 and 2012. And if you look at the top three sets of bars in the bottom, you can really see what's happened with this trade-off. State funding has declined precipitously. Tuitions have had to rise to take up the gap. And then the other sources of funding are the federal, state, contracts and private gifts and grants, and make up the revenue picture. We did think it was important, again, to show graphically the percent change in state support for public higher education. This represents all colleges and universities, not just the public research universities, per full-time equivalent student in constant dollars. And so we need to keep this in mind. Everybody needs to keep this in mind when they want to talk about inefficiencies or why tuitions are rising or why it costs so much. This is the principal reason that it's costing so much. So what are states doing with their funding? Why is it changing so much? Well, this also came as a little bit of a surprise to us when we looked at the ways that states are spending their money. And if you look between 1986, or the last three decades, and 2013, and look at percentage increases adjusted for inflation and general fund expenditures, higher education has grown only 5.6%. Elementary and secondary education, surely an important part of our educational spectrum, has grown by 69%, but corrections has grown by 141%. And in fact, we observe that in 11 states, correction spending has surpassed higher education spending. And it's pretty sobering, I think, for the country to realize that. So we hear a lot about out-of-control tuition cost, and so we looked and gathered data from independent sources about what's the driver of rising tuition increase at public research universities between 2001 and 2011, and almost 80% is related to the decrease in state support. There has been some increase in construction spending. Most of that is renovations and introducing new kinds of laboratories and new teaching spaces, 6% for administration and support. And much of that is due to the increased regulatory burden on universities and providing more access to students who couldn't come before. I mean, I point out all the time that we offer a lot more mental health services now than we did 20 or 30 years ago. And that's a good thing, because we are opening our doors to students who couldn't have come before. But it cost, and this is part of the reason for what's happening with our increased cost. And then 9% is increased spending on construction and on instruction as we bring new technologies into the classroom. You know, we often get criticized because some pundits have proposed that our administrative costs are out of control or we're hiring too many administrators. Well, here's the actual data between 2002 and 2012, if you can look at any category there. And I will note that this bottom one, that has changed almost not at all, represents the executive, administrative, and managerial workforce. And what this represents is the number of staff per 1,000 FTE students. So yes, our numbers of students have increased, and so yes, we've had to hire people to account for that, but there have been almost no changes per student, so that we are not out of control in terms of hiring people at these institutions. One of the most interesting parts of this Lincoln Project for Bob and me, and certainly for other members of our commission, was going around the country to regional meetings, and we held many, many regional meetings. These are our conclusions from the regional meetings, that state disinvestment is a national phenomenon. We think it's irreversible. We are recommending that states really do look at a way to stabilize and reinvest in these universities, but certainly the disinvestment is not happening in one state as opposed to another. The disinvestment has been largely compensated by increases in tuition, and in some institutions, more reliance on out-of-state and international students to make up for the difference. The commitment to access varies wildly between the different states, and one of the things that I've been so impressed about is I know that you've had a problem in California with funding, but you have Cal Grants, which are need-based financial aid, which is an enormous benefit to Californians. And I think it's one of the reasons that California is showing such a vibrant economic activity, because I think the Cal Grants represent about $12,000 or $13,000 per student for financial need. Just to give you the comparison, in Michigan, it's $700. So I've got $12,000 versus $700. We do almost nothing in Michigan to help low-income students at the state level. The universities obviously do. The other thing that we discovered in going around the country is that university leadership has been very impressive and adept in adapting to the local context in the midst of this great recession. We heard story after story about how universities are embedding themselves in their local economies, their local communities, and in the state, and it was really inspiring to hear what they're doing. We also came to the conclusion that IT, where there's a lot of hype about, you know, this is going to be our answer to low-cost educational delivery, we really don't see examples that this has been successful, though there is, the growth of hybrid classrooms and flipped classrooms for some of these big gateway courses can be very effective. It's not necessarily low cost, but we do think that IT has a very important role in improving graduation rates, and we found some extremely good examples of how this is happening. Philanthropy is going to be a part of the solution for the future, and most public universities are beginning to become much more active in philanthropy. But we will note that private research universities average 4 times more gift dollars per FTE than public, so we have a long way to go. And then finally, universities have to work continuously on operational efficiency. We've seen some good examples, but this is something that cannot stop. It's not over. It has to go on all the time. So now I want to turn it over to Phil Bredesen, and he's going to give us a little sense about the state context and, as a governor, what he faced.